Mr. Zahor, first of all, thank you very much for making some time to talk to us on our Belgian Rich List project. As an entrepreneur, you have been active in Kiev for a very long time. How do you view the current situation in the country for the moment?
Well, it's a pity that we reached this kind of situation. And of course, as a businessman who has a lot of business interest in Kiev and Ukraine as a whole, my heart goes away with whatever is happening there. And it's not that I'm only doing the business there. I have a family connection. My wife is from there. My kids were born there. So, of course, it is something which is but someone or somebody or some countries could have avoided. But now what we have actually.
Yes. Ukraine gets a lot of words as support from Europe and the United States, but few actions. Is that also your vision on the facts?
As far as I can see, you know, this is a fight of two boxers in different categories. So one is lightweight and other one is heavyweight.
Yeah.
And for the lightweight, he's fighting with passion and with zeal. He can withstand maybe 1, 2, 3, 4 rounds.
Yes.
But because this bout is about 10 rounds, so at the end of the day, the heavyweight boxer will find somehow, maybe with a foul or without a foul, but we can see that he's doing a foul right now. He will find a way to hit him and knock him down. So that's why we need the referee to interfere in between. And referee, I'm not meaning like United Nations, because we all understand that United Nations today is a paper organization. It can pass resolutions, but it cannot do anything at all. So I mean to say, when I call referee, it means the outside country, the NATO and EU, where Ukraine is not a member of, but still it is an independent organization, and they should avoid Ukraine to be completely destroyed by a country which is much superior in military power from Ukraine.
Yes, if you look at the United Nations, you see that countries like China, India, and the Arab Emirates, they do not support sanctions against Russia. Is there a global division in the world?
Well, there is actually some of the country. There is definitely now. The world is still a bipolar. It's the time when from 1991 till, let's say, 2014, or the time when the Syrian crisis happened, the world was a single polar when America was deciding everything. And they were deciding also in their own favor. They decided to invade Iraq. They decided to take off Syria. They went against Gaddafi and Libya and the summer revolutions, etc. So in this situation, we cannot say actually. We have to say the bad is bad and the right is right. So if America was doing bad at that time, doesn't give Russia a right to do bad this time. So we have to condemn America for that, whatever they have done. And we have to still condemn Russia for what they are doing. So, of course, the countries like India, I understand, because they are very much dependent upon the supply, the Russian supply, and not only for the oil, wheat, and soybean, not soybean, but this sunflower oil. They bought by about $2 billion of stuff. And the oil also, they buy a lot from them. And similarly, a lot of military cooperation between India and Russia. So India has taken a stance that, of course, it can see that Russia is an aggressor, but they don't want to offend Russia by saying it loudly. China, I think China, the problem of China is that China also understands what Russia is doing, but China would rather take side of Russia or take a quite telling that China is not taking side, but it will not go with America.
Yeah. You said that Putin is going for the final victory. Does that mean that you do not believe in the peace talks he's holding for the moment?
Well, when peace talks starts with the conditions, and the conditions are kind of that, okay, you give me this thing, you accept this thing, and similar kind of thing. That means a total capitulation for Zelensky, because the Ukrainian people who are fighting a brave war with Russia, they will then say, okay, what then we fought for? If we had to, at the end of the day, we had to give away everything. So I think there could be some peace, but that might have been at a point with some diplomacy that, okay, I have been telling long ago, since even 2014, that this Donetsk and Lugansk, they are gone from you. There are different people living there. Those people who were for Ukraine, they migrated to Ukraine. And the people who are left over there, they are old people who could not get away. There were some people who are still have some sympathies for Ukraine, young people, but their father and mother, they could not leave, so they were also there. But those people are quite small in numbers. So I would have given away those parts which were captured in 2014 as a deal. And but now what Russia is asking, that give me the rest of the two-third of Donbass as well, which was not taken away at that time. But in that part, these Russian-speaking Ukrainians are living who do not want to be part of Russia or these breakaway republics, which have no future.
Mm. Yes. If you look at Putin, as long as he supplies gas to Europe, he can finance his war machine. Is that correct?
It's very correct. It's very correct. So in order to push Putin in the corner, of course, the Europeans have to tighten their belts, and they have to get ready for certain measures which we are not quite used to. The harsh thing which right now, let's say, in Mariupol is happening, where people are not getting water, not getting food, and being shelled. So, but for European, it's not going to be that harsh. The only harsh thing is, instead of paying $1 for the gas, you have to pay $2 maybe. And in order to so this is kind of your contribution towards ending the war and slowing down this war machinery.
So in some way we have to pay for the naivety of our political leaders?
Yes. At the end of the day, you have to do it.
Yeah. Besides of this military conflict, there's also a growing economic war in progress. Can Putin survive this economic war?
Well, for some time, yes. In the long term, I think he cannot. We can see that already 2-3 big companies, even Lukoil, they have already started saying they are not going straight away against condemning Putin, but they are saying that we should stop this war and we should stop this bloodshed and things like that. So I think the crack, we can see that it is started happening. And in the long run, what is going to happen is that even the oligarch, which in year 2000 and 2001, 2002, they made a deal with Putin that anybody who wanted to do business with Russia, and there were some conditions for all the oligarch. The conditions were that you will never take part in politics, you will never finance the politicians, and the second thing is whatever you have got, you can keep 50% for you and 50% for Putin and his cronies. And then you are the king, you do everything, we will support you. So that has been the game plan since 2000 and today. Now, these oligarchs, this Putin was kind of a cover for them. Now, when they say that this cover is instead of giving them money, due to this cover, they are not getting even their own 50% what they was promised to, then they will find some way how to get rid of Putin. Every one of those, they are billionaires, and they are not single billionaires. They have tens of billions of dollars, in fact. And if you are being stripped of half of that value, or maybe now even there are more. So like Lukoil has lost 90% of his share value. So instead of, they say, we have lost 50% of Putin's and 40% of our value as well. We are left with only 10%. Now out of that 10%, we still have to share with him 5% for him, 5% for us. So there will be a person or company or group of people who will find out that being together with Putin today is more harmful for them than without him. And similarly, if you look at the surrounding of the Putin, most of them are 60s and in their 60s and 70s, like Lavrov and other people. So you cannot expect anything good from them because they are the product of Soviet Union. But there are youngsters who are in their 40s and they are in their 50s who are their advisors. So they can find also way somehow, like that young lady came on the Channel One and showed that no war, etc. So there are people in Russia, courageous people, who can come out or who can even decide somehow. There could be a coup, instead of going into a long war, maybe they try to get something short. So there could be something coming out short term, or if these people have no courage at all, then you will get it like the long term, like you had in the Afghanistan war from 1979 to 1989, when Russia was economically bankrupt and they had to give in to the American pressure, and the 15 republics were broke away into 15 countries, and the Warsaw Pact countries were also gone from the influence of Russia. So maybe after 8-10 years, when people will see that there's nothing to eat, nothing to nobody, they cannot go out, they are living as the people were living in Soviet Union, and the immigration would be the similar kind, like at that time the Jews were immigrated. So people were getting out of Russia by getting invitations or sponsorship from their relatives, etc., etc. So nobody want to live in the 20s, like in the 1960s. So it's a different time, actually. There was no Facebook, there was no Instagram, no TikTok there. So we are living in a different world. The youngsters who have been studied outside also, and they are now being pushed also to live, go back to their countries, some of those. So these people, they also enjoying some. The only thing they are not enjoying is they cannot criticize Putin. Otherwise, they have right to live like everybody in the West. So these the combination of all these things, would crack the whole Russia and convert them into some small countries like Chechnya, Dagestan, Tatarstan, Yakutia. So every district will become a country. So we will see something like Soviet Union breakup of 1989 to 1991, or the Yugoslavia in the 2000s. Similar kind of stuff we might see in 8 to 10 years.
Mm-hmm. You yourself as an entrepreneur in Ukraine, how much damage do you incur in this conflict?
Well, fortunately, till now we have all of our factories and our residential buildings and commercial real estate, whatever is there, it's not being hit as we talk today, but it can happen anytime because Putin is not targeting now any military objects. They are now targeting the civilian people, and he's doing the same thing what he has done in Syria or in Grozny, in Chechnya. So right now, of course, except for the business which is not working, at least these things are intact.
Yes. One of the commodities you trade in is sunflower oil. This is a basic product for the Belgian producers of potato chips. They say that their supplies will be exhausted within 1 or 2 weeks. Is this war a war of attrition?
Yes. It's unfortunately, now the both countries, even Russia and Ukraine, they both have stopped export of any edible good. Yeah. Including the sunflower oil. So this thing will affect everybody in Europe or wherever you are, because it's not going to go away.
Yeah. As you have said in the beginning of our conversation, your wife was born in Ukraine. How does she view the current situation?
Well, my wife, on the contrary, she was born in Russia, the Far East of Russia. But her mother was Ukrainian, and then they moved to Budapest, and then from Budapest they went back. So her father was military pilot, who is originally from Russia, from Moscow, and he himself hates Russia for whatever they are doing. Kamalia, she has made her mind in 2014, and since then she has not giving any concerts, not participating in any of the Russian programs. So she self-exiled herself from Russia since 2014. She is very active against the war. If you look at her Facebook, her Instagram, what she is doing, we are in Poland right now. And for the last 10 days, we are sending a lot of humanitarian aids to Poland, to Ukraine back. And now she is meeting the Russian, the Ukrainian diaspora, who have been, who are the refugees here, and meeting the orphans and other people, and helping them also, because she thinks that this ordeal is happening not only in Ukraine, but for the people who have left everything in Ukraine and came to other countries like Poland and Germany. So she's now opening her own charity in Germany also. And she's busy sending people to different places where they can find some shelter. She's helping those orphanage with some food stuff or medical or whatever they need, because a lot of people, they are ready to provide shelter, but they cannot pay for the food and other stuff. So these organizations, they also need some help.
Yes, but you and your wife have been active in charity in Ukraine for a long time. Are all those efforts now destroyed?
Yeah, they are totally destroyed. There's nothing left there. So before we were quite involved in cardio child cardio hospital, and we made a totally one intensive care unit for the kids, and about 10,000 little newborn child who needed the surgery, they were going through this intensive care unit. So almost every year we were saving the lives of about 10,000 little kids. That is that we don't know what is happening there, but there was, I think the nearby place that was also bombed in Kiev.
Mm-hmm.
Now we are trying to do similar thing, but we are trying to send the medicines to and insulins. We know that in some of the in Nikolaev there are a hospital who needs insulin. So we are buying insulins. We are looking for help for insulin. So we are sending insulin there. So whatever we can do and whatever we are being asked to provide, we are doing.
Okay. As a final question, Mr. Zahor. Once this conflict is over, what do you think will have changed in this world?
Well, first of all, if this conflict will over without being Ukraine pushed to the corner, then I think in the world, no other country will try to invade your neighbors or your I would say a weak neighbor rather, and if the world will take the similar kind of stance that has taken today, except for few countries, you can see everybody was united in this war against Russia. So if we always get this concerted effort and do always go ahead to punish the evil, I think then the world is going to be a much better place after this thing. The second thing what I see is Ukraine is totally destroyed. And our help should not finish at this point that the war is finished. We have to rebuild Ukraine. We have to bring those people back to their home. We don't want that many refugees all over Europe. So we have to take care of those people to go back. And if we want a civilized country in Europe, which the Ukraine is, then we need to give them a shelter in the house of EU, and it should become an EU country.
Okay, on this thought, thank you very much for this conversation, Mr. Zahor.
Thanks a lot. Thanks. My pleasure.